I'm going to try to take you on a kind of historical tour of the internet and as quickly as possible bring you to the present to say a little bit about what still needs to be done. So this is about unfinished business on the internet. I can guarantee you that the list of things I believe need to be done is still too short, and you will probably have additional ideas that should be added to the list. One of the wonderful things about the internet is you can keep adding to this list and deciding to do things to make it better. And I'll try to finish up with a little bit of view into the future. But let me take you back in time to 1969. This is when the predecessor to the internet was developed. It was called the ARPANET, which stood for the Advanced Research Projects Agency Network. This was a Defense Department initiative to use packet switching to link a dozen universities around the United States together. The reason that the Defense Department felt the need to build this network is that those research universities were doing research in artificial intelligence and computer science for the Defense Department. And they kept asking for a new computer every year, and even the Defense Department couldn't afford to buy a new one for 12 different universities. So they said, we're going to build a net and you are going to share resources. So we built the ARPANET and put it into operation in 1969. I was still a graduate student at UCLA and wrote the software to connect a Sigma 7 computer in the lower right there to the first node of the ARPANET. Well, not long thereafter, a few years later, my colleague Robert Kahn and I developed the concept of connecting multiple packet switch networks to each other, which we eventually called the internet. And in 1977, we had a major milestone. We had developed the TCP IP protocols. We had implemented them on several operating systems. We had built three different packet switch networks. The original ARPANET, which is the very funny shape. Let's see if, I don't know if I have a pointer here. No, there. You see this very funny shape. It turns out that the ARPANET was extended into Europe through an internal satellite connection by this 1977 date. So the ARPANET is spanning the ocean. We have a satellite network, which is over the Atlantic, connecting the western part of Europe to the eastern part of the US through a packet satellite system with multiple ground stations. And we had, in addition to that, a mobile packet radio network, which was designed for mobile data communication. Now, keep in mind, this is the mid-1970s. We are experimenting with what you carry around in your pocket today. But what we had then were a cubic foot of radio costing $50,000 each. But what was exciting to me as I was running this particular test from Washington, D.C., where I was running the internet program for the Defense Department, is it was the first time that we had shown that the TCP/IP protocols could link together three very different packet switch nets. The satellite net went through a synchronous satellite hop, so that's a quarter of a second up and down, and of course another quarter of a second back at a data rate of about 64 kilobits a second. In the case of the packet radio network over here, the packets could go 100 kilobits a second, and in some cases 400 kilobits a second, while the van was moving up and down the San Francisco Bayshore Freeway. And the ARPANET over here was running at about 50 kilobits a second using dedicated telephone lines. The scenario that this represented were mobile vehicles in military use, fixed installations on the ARPANET, fixed computer installations, and ships at sea being interconnected by satellite. So that's what this model represented. And I was pretty excited about the fact that on November 22nd, 1977, after about 4 years of work, that we were able to demonstrate that this protocol could bind these different kinds of nets to each other. So that was a major milestone for the internet. In the mid-1980s, the American Research Establishment, in this case the National Science Foundation, but also in addition to this, NASA and the Department of Energy, implemented the TCP/IP protocols in their own networks and joined this growing internet backbone. This was a very important step for the academic community because it connected some 3,000 research universities around the United States. In addition to that, the NSF also funded international connections to link the academic networks of other countries to this growing backbone system. And so this turned out, NSF in particular, turned out to be a very key player in the evolution of the internet system. Now you see what the internet looks like today. It's a very big and colorful thing. Hundreds of thousands of networks are interconnected to each other all around the world. One of the interesting facts about the internet is that there is no central control. The system is fully distributed. Each of the networks of the internet is operated independently of the others. The operators might be for-profit, they might be not-for-profit, they might be universities, they might be in the private sector, they might be government-operated, and in some cases, they might even be individuals who are running little pieces of the internet, just like you and I do at home with our Wi-Fi networks and our high-speed connections to the internet service providers. So this is a distributed environment with a great deal of independence built into it. The only reason this works is that all of the players have agreed to use the same internet protocol suite standardized by the Internet Engineering Task Force and the Internet Architecture Board, both of which are housed in an organization called the Internet Society. So this is a grand collaboration. It supports multiple business models. It doesn't dictate any of that. The operators choose whatever hardware they want. They choose whatever software they want. The only restriction being that everything uses the same protocol suite, so we have interoperability. So that's what the internet is like today. One of the most important experiments in the evolution of the internet is this notion of multi-stakeholder policy development. When the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers was created in 1998, it was organized around the idea that the participants in policy making for the domain name system and for the internet address space should comprise the people who would be affected by the policy. That meant governments had a role to play in the government advisory committee. The private sector had a role to play for the internet service providers, for example. The technical community, the standards making part of it, and the research community had a role to play. Civil society, the users of the internet, were also part of this multi-stakeholder structure. This was not common in those days, in the late 1990s, and so in some ways this was quite a big experiment. The other thing that I want to emphasize is that when the internet was begun, this is back in 1973, many of these institutions did not exist. They were created when the need arose, and this is a very important concept in the internet environment. The creation of new technology and the creation of new institutions when the need arises. So ICANN gets created many years after the internet was turned on in 1983, when the need for this kind of global coordination arose. Internet Society was created when the federal government, US federal government, said they didn't want to underwrite the cost of running the Internet Engineering Task Force anymore because it was so much a part of the private sector equipment makers and software makers, and so on. We created new regional internet registries to distribute internet address space as the effort to do this increased. For example, LACNIC, which takes care of internet address allocation here in Latin America, was created after ICAM was formed in order to serve the needs of the population here in Latin America. It's especially important to recognize that the Net Mundial initiative, which was taken here in Brazil in 2014, was an incredibly important milestone in the multi-stakeholder model of internet governance, because it produced a very well-received description of the roles and functions of the multiple stakeholder model in managing internet governance activity. And so Brazil gets a great deal of credit, the CGIBR group especially, for having organized and executed this important 2014 milestone. Another thing which I think is very critical is that we can see the need on the network now for safety for the users. Internet is not a 100% safe place. There are people out there who are hacking. There are people with malware who spread that to infect your computers. There are issues with privacy, especially if someone has hacked into an account, for example. There are questions about reliability. The more we rely on the internet, the more we rely on our smartphones using the internet, the more damage is done when it doesn't work the way it's supposed to. If it's unreliable, it really disturbs our business lives and it disturbs our personal lives as well. The idea that this is really one network made up of a bunch of independent nets, but looks like one net, is very important. It should work the same no matter where you are in the world. When you do a domain name lookup to go to a website, no matter where you are, the internet would like it to be true that you end up in the same place. Now, you and I both know that that isn't always the case, that there are situations where some actors interfere with domain name lookups. They might block them. They might actually try to redirect the traffic to where you don't want to go. That is a security issue, and it's one that we have to address. It's also an issue about the utility of the network. If it's a single network or behaves like a single network, we can rely on it everywhere we go. If it's broken up, if it's fragmented, its utility is diminished in a very dramatic way. And finally, I would have to say that the internet's success has been due in part to the freedom of expression that is built into its architecture, the freedom of access to the network. While conditions will vary from country to country and jurisdiction to jurisdiction, the philosophy behind the internet is that it's openly available to anyone who wishes to get access to it, to get information from it, to put information into it, to invent new applications, to interact with and collaborate and discover people who might be of interest. So this openness has been a core value for the internet, and if we don't preserve it, the utility of the network will diminish. One of the things which really belongs in the unfinished business category has to do with transnational agreements. These are agreements that cross international boundaries and can be very, very useful in facilitating trade, for example. And one very helpful thing which is missing from the framework of internet at the application level is common agreements on how to do e-commerce. How do we negotiate contracts online? Can we digitally sign a contract? And is the digital signature equally valid in all jurisdictions that we might care about? What technology is used to generate the digital signature? How are the identities of the parties in these online contracts confirmed? You don't want to sign a contract with someone that you don't recognize or cannot identify. We need technology and we need agreements in order to instantiate this commonality that is needed in order to conduct e-commerce and to negotiate contracts online. We need cooperative legal regimes. We know that, for example, some parties on the internet may be attacked by someone who is in a different jurisdiction, maybe it's a different country. The problem now is, how do we deal with the victim? What do we do if we have identified the perpetrator of an attack, but that person is in a different country? Is there any agreement between countries to cope with this problem? We are going to have regimes, probably multilateral ones, that will allow this problem to be addressed so that parties who are harmed on the network have recourse and that countries can cooperate with each other in order to provide justice. This is not going to be an easy thing to do. It may turn out to be bilateral in some cases. It may be multilateral in others. But without it, we have serious risk. We have problems of safety. And this will discourage users from using the network if they feel that they are not safe and are not protected against some of these harms or have no recourse in the event that they have experienced harm on the net. So we have serious work to do on a transnational basis. In addition to all of the mechanics and the legal frameworks and so on, many of us are becoming increasingly interested in how the internet can be used to make people's lives better. We know that it can provide information that can be helpful to people, whether they are shopping, looking for healthcare, looking for education, looking for a variety of other things. But we need very much to make sure that there are certain properties that the internet offers that will in fact be a positive benefit to the people who use it. So, for example, it can't be useful if it's not affordable. And we know that there are places still in the world where internet access and the equipment that's needed is in fact too expensive for them to afford, so we need to work on that. It needs to be accessible in several senses for people who are blind, for people who have motor problems or have hearing problems. The internet's applications need to be adapted so as to make its utility accessible to them. It also needs to be accessible in the literal sense of the word. We have to be able to get to the net when we need it and want it. I can say that high-speed mobile communication has been very, very helpful in closing that gap and making the internet more accessible to people who might otherwise not get access to it. And of course, it won't be very useful if its content isn't helpful. And often that means having local content. I mean, here we are in Brasilia. If we're looking for maybe some help with plumbing, it doesn't do us much good to find a plumber in São Paulo. We need to find a plumber in Brasilia. You could make up your own scenarios. It means that local content in local languages is important to make the network worthy of people's attention and use. We also need to extend the network where it has not yet gone. And to do that, we know that a private sector incentive is needed so that the private sector can make investments to put in the infrastructure that's needed to support the internet protocols and the applications that sit on top. And so we need this kind of incentive for investment. We need to provide for competition among providers of internet service so the users have choice. This is probably one of the most important desirable characteristics of internet environments. Users have the ability to choose among various providers at various levels, whether it's access to the basic internet itself or it's access to various applications. Having users be able to choose among competitors is a very important criterion. We can also see that for the net to be people-centered, it should have foci that are beneficial to them for education, for example, or for healthcare, or for new work, which might be facilitated by access to the internet. Although there is controversy over some of the new businesses that have arisen on the network, Uber being an example. It is a very interesting example of a network-enabled way for people to work, to discover people who need their help driving from one point to another. So regardless of how you might feel about Uber in particular, the thing I want to emphasize is that the network gives freedom to invent new ways of putting people to work and of satisfying people's needs. And that is a very important people-centered focus on the net. And certainly, the network can facilitate both domestic and international trade. Even in an economy as large as Brazil's, there is a bigger economy called the world economy. And one of the most attractive things that we can offer to companies that start here in Brazil is to have access to markets that are outside of the country and maybe even outside the region. So this suggests to me that when we're talking to startups and young people who are trying to invent new businesses, that while they may start out with a local focus, it's important for their growth to be thinking about international services, cross country borders, and addressing world markets. I also have to say that getting everyone connected is a non-trivial exercise. The American State Department, together with the World Bank, announced something called the Global Connect Initiative. And there are a number of places and countries and institutions that are initiating efforts to create more connectivity. Google, for example, has built a fiber backbone in Kampala, Uganda. The purpose is to provide a wholesale service that that retailers can resell to consumers and to businesses in the region. The idea here is to give the consumers choice by allowing competition and to facilitate that business by providing a wholesale backbone system. There are, I'm sure you can make up other kinds of examples, but this idea of seeking to increase connectivity around the world both spreads the internet further, and it also increases its robustness by having more and more connectivity linking the pieces of the net together. None of this would work very well unless the operation is sustainable technically and sustainable from the business point of view. So the kinds of initiatives where someone parachutes in, builds some infrastructure, and leaves often does not produce a sustainable outcome. You need to have people who are living locally, who have the right technical training, and have the right business model so that they can sustain the operation of the underlying internet system and the applications that sit on top of it. So this clearly tells us that we have to keep business models in mind at the same time as we're trying to pursue technical challenges of getting more internet in place. And finally, this is just my partial list of technical developments that are still to be completed in the internet environment. And the point I want to make in this slide is that despite the fact that the internet was designed in 1973 and refined and more or less standardized in 1978, it is still capable of evolving. There are still opportunities for improving the way it works, for adding new functionality, and supporting new kinds of applications. Sometimes these applications only happen because the network has gotten faster, or computers have gotten faster, or there's more memory, or they're smaller, or they're less expensive. There are a variety of these parameters that determine whether or not these components of the internet can be affordable. And as these milestones are met, people invent new ways of using the network because it's now possible to do that. And so I don't see any end at the moment to this continuing wave of creativity. So for example, we clearly need standards, and there are many institutions that have contributed to the internet's considerable collection of standards. I mean, TCP/IP was at the core, but there are literally hundreds of other standards that are part of the internet environment that make it useful and make it possible for people to provide products and services. One of the things which you should worry about and I worry about, is that the internet is mostly software. Yes, there are routers. Yes, you have mobiles. Yes, you have laptops and tablets. But they don't do anything unless they have software in them. Now, this is both good news and bad news. The good news is that software makes things work, and the bad news is that software has bugs. And so the problem we face is figuring out how to fix the bugs in devices that have been deployed somewhere in the internet. You all have mobiles, and you know that they need upgrades, either for new functionality or to fix errors and mistakes that might actually be exploited to do harm. So we have to make sure that all the devices in the internet that bear software can be updated at need. Now, this turns out to be not as easy as it sounds. And the reason for this is that you don't want the bad guy to provide new software for your mobile or your internet-enabled refrigerator or your entertainment system. So the question is, how do you know whether the new software is coming from a legitimate source? That's why we have to have strong end-to-end authentication. The devices at the edges of the net that receive new software have to be able to determine whether it's coming from a legitimate source. That's partly a configuration problem. That's partly a cryptography problem, where cryptography is being used for strongly authenticating the source or the destination. You have, this is the bottle of vodka that they had offered to me. So what this means is that my speech is going to get more and more funny. At least I will think it's funny. You may not think it's funny, but I will. Now, the problem is there's no flat surface here to put this on, so there we are. That'd be pretty funny if we put it right down. Okay, so here we are. Now we need the strong end-to-end authentication in order to make sure that devices get the right updated software. There's also a great deal of need, and you all have already, I'm sure, discussed this, for confidentiality and privacy protection. This is not only a personal issue, this could be a business issue. If you're carrying out a business transaction, maybe it's an acquisition, maybe it's a major buy, maybe you're just discussing the terms and conditions in a competitive environment, it's essential that you have the ability to make confidential the transactions that you're engaged in, and so we need cryptography in order to do that. One of the mistakes that Bob Kahn and I made in the early days of internet design is that we underestimated how much address space would be needed. In other words, how could we accommodate terminations on the network? And in all honesty, in 1973, we used a 32-bit address space, which, if fully populated, would give 4.3 billion terminations. And to be honest, in 1973, that sounded like more than enough for an experiment that we were trying to do. We didn't even know if it could work. Well, about 1990 or so, we started to realize that the network was growing very quickly. More networks were coming because of local area networks, Ethernet, Wi-Fi, and so on. And so the Internet Engineering Task Force began the job of designing a new protocol format called IP version 6. It has a 128-bit address space. If that were fully populated, you would have 3.4 times 10 to the 38th addresses in the network. And I figure that's enough to last until after I'm dead, and then it's somebody else's problem. So that is the current preferred addressing structure and packet format. It's been a long, long haul. This was standardized in 1996. There was very little uptake. We ran out of the version 4 32-bit address space in 2011. I thought, surely at that point, everyone, the ISPs in particular, would recognize it's time to adopt and turn on IP version 6. But that was not the case. People used various kinds of hacks things like network address translation, among others, in order to somehow stretch that 32-bit address space. But I can tell you, as of this year, 2016, there is finally recognition that there are going to be a lot of devices on the network. In addition to the mobiles, the Internet of Things is upon us. They are starting to show up in the marketplace. They are going to need billions of addresses. And so we're finally starting to see serious implementation of IPv6 in parallel with IPv4 in the internet service provider space. I have another rant, which normally takes an hour, which I will not undertake right now, but every single one of you with a mobile has probably taken a number of photographs during this week. You probably expect those images to last forever. You might copy them from one mobile to another. You might copy them onto a laptop or an external hard drive. But your belief that these bits are somehow indestructible because they're not physical exactly, they're somehow logical, that belief is only true for a finite period of time. This is particularly true when we're talking about documents that require software in order to interact with them. A spreadsheet, for example, a text processing program that lets you write text, maybe a sketching program. Those complex digital objects that are created by that software have to run on some computer somewhere. The application has to be executed on the machine. An operating system has to support the application. And of course, the operating system has to run on some hardware base. 100 years from now, even if you still have the files, you may not be able to get the operating system to run on machines of the future. You may not be able to get the application to run. You may have a collection of digital files which are worthless because you can't use them, you can't display them, and you can't interact with them. I call that a digital dark age. And I'm very, very concerned that we don't have in place a set of standard procedures and mechanisms for making sure that the digital content that we create today has longevity many decades into the future. Some people will tell you it doesn't matter, the important stuff will keep getting copied and the stuff that's not important will just go away. The trouble with that theory is that sometimes you don't know what's going to be important 100 years from now. You don't know what your descendants will care about 100 or 1,000 years from now. And so we have some technical problems that have to be solved to preserve digital content. For example, we might have to emulate old hardware in virtual machines. We might run old operating systems in that emulated environment. We might run applications on top of the operating system and then load the files. So we can run the old applications in the context in which they were created. There are examples of this already underway at Carnegie Mellon University, for example. So we have to work our way through that. This leaves out other things like who has the ownership of the software, of the operating system, of the application. What about business models? How many companies last 1,000 years or 2,000 years? I mean, I can't think of very many. The church has done pretty well. It's lasted for 2,000 years. And interestingly enough, it was partly involved in the preservation of content when the monks were copying Greek manuscripts and Latin manuscripts onto new vellum. I don't know whether we should ask the church to become the digital archive. There are other institutions that last for a long time. For example, breweries have been around for 500 years sometimes. I haven't figured out how to connect the business model of a brewery with digital preservation, but maybe after a few glasses of beer, I'd be able to figure that out. So we need to work on that problem, or we will end up losing an enormous amount of content that we create today in digital form, which has no other representation. Just a couple of other things, and then I'll have one or two more charts. One thing that you all are familiar with, every day you type domain names and URLs, you click on hyperlinks to move around in the World Wide Web. But every one of you has experienced the 404 page not found phenomenon. The reason that happens is that sometimes the page that you're trying to go to has been removed from the serving host, maybe because the operator of the website decided they didn't have room for it, or maybe the website has gone away, or maybe somebody forgot to pay the rent on the domain name, and so the domain name no longer resolves to an internet address. Domain names are not permanent. And so we may need to introduce new identifier spaces that have the property that once assigned, they never go away, they are never removed, but they have permanence. That will have to be part of the preservation picture if we expect to have identifiers for digital content that will be resolvable many, many years into the future. And it should be obvious that broadband is our friend here. The higher the speed, the more things we can do with the internet, finding ways of delivering wired and wireless broadband at affordable prices in all the places that could use it is yet another unfinished business. Now I want to leap into the somewhat more distant future. This looks like it's just a science fiction slide. I tell you, it is not. Something not quite this elaborate is already in operation. It's the extension of the internet across the solar system. My colleagues at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory and I began work on this system in 1998. Our thought was that most of the exploration of the solar system that had been done up until that time used point-to-point radio links to interact with the spacecraft, to send commands, and to get back data. We thought if there were a richer network in the solar system, we would be able to support more complex missions, both robotic and manned missions. And so we asked ourselves, can we design an interplanetary internet? And well, we started thinking we could use TCP/IP for this. We thought, well, it works on Earth, so maybe it will work on Mars, or it should work on Mars, and it probably would. But we discovered very quickly that the TCP/IP protocols did not work between the planets. And there's a reason for this. The speed of light is too slow. Between Earth and Mars, when our planets are closest together, it's 35 million miles. At the speed of light, it takes about 3.5 minutes to go that distance, and of course another 3.5 minutes to come back. It gets worse. When Earth and Mars are farthest apart in their orbits, it's 235 million miles, and it takes 20 minutes one way, 40 minutes round trip. The TCP/IP protocols were originally designed with a very simple flow control scheme. Basically, when you run out of room on the receiving side, you say to the sender, stop, I ran out of room. Well, this works well if the recipient of that signal is a few hundred milliseconds away. But what if it takes 20 minutes or an hour to tell the sender you're out of room? The sender is going to keep sending stuff, and you won't be able to put it anywhere. It will fall on the floor and blow away in the wind. So flow control doesn't work very well over these distances. There's actually another problem. The planets are rotating, at least most of them, and we haven't figured out how to stop that. And so if we're trying to talk to something on the surface of the planet and the planet rotates, for a while we can't talk to it because the planet's in the way. So this is both a variably delayed and disrupted environment. So my colleagues and I started work on a delay and disruption tolerant networking system. That is what has been implemented. The prototypes of that software are running on Mars, on the rovers that are still operating, the Mars Science Lander and the two Spirit and Opportunity rovers, and in the orbiters that were originally deployed around Mars to map the surface of the planet to decide where the rovers were supposed to go. So we reprogrammed the orbiters and the rovers to use the orbiters as a store and forward relay in order to get information back to Earth. It turned out that implementing that gave us 4 times more bandwidth back to Earth than we were getting from the surface of the planet back to the deep space network on Earth. We implemented this same protocol for the Phoenix lander that landed on the North Pole of Mars, because there wasn't any direct path from the North Pole back to Earth. And when the Mars Science Lander arrived, it too used these store and forward protocols. We have the protocols running on the International Space Station as well. And there, we are doing experiments with real-time control of rovers on Earth from the International Space Station, which is sort of like what would happen if the astronauts were in orbit around Mars, steering a rover directly. You can do that from Mars orbit because it's close by and the delay is low. You couldn't do that from Earth. By the time you found out you'd driven over a cliff, it's too late. 20 minutes later, the spacecraft is gone. So what we're hoping will happen is that we can standardize these protocols internationally, which we have done. All the spacefaring nations are free to use these protocols, and they can implement them on their spacecraft that are launched for scientific missions. And when the mission has been completed, the spacecraft can be repurposed to become a node in an interplanetary backbone. And so as the decades pass in the 21st century, we can accrete an interplanetary communication system to support both manned and robotic exploration of the solar system. And so this last slide just reiterates the key messages I want you to take away. The first one is, internet, despite its age, invites evolution. You are free to implement new evolving capabilities. Second, open access standards and applications foster the growth and utility of the network. Let's keep an environment open to these things to allow our young and creative people an opportunity to contribute to the further expansion and utility of the network. We need to do something about reinforcing public trust in the network. That means establishing transnational standards for protecting people's safety and privacy. And finally, if we want to see the internet as a tool for growing GDP, we need to make sure that we are catering to entrepreneurs, providing them an environment where they can get capital, where they can get access to talent, where they can get access to markets and make use of the internet in order to build their businesses. So I'll stop there. I want to thank you very much for allowing me to take time in this afternoon. And I'm told that if there is time that we can have a little bit of Q&A, and I'm happy to try to engage. Thank you so much.
Well done. I'm going to invite you to sit, so you've been standing too long. So Vint, we've been told that it took 35 years for the radio to reach 50 million users. TV took 17, and internet took 1. In your view, with all the track record you have going backwards, looking forward, what do you think it is now, the rate of speed of change?
So I've heard these statistics more than once, and I have trouble with them because from my point of view, the internet started in 1973. That was 43 years ago. And although it now reaches 3.5 billion people, it took 43 years from my point of view to get there. So I think, however, that what we are seeing is that platforms like the Internet of Things or cyber-physical systems are becoming less and less expensive. It's easy to internet enable all kinds of equipment, whether it's household appliances or office equipment or automobiles and maybe someday airplanes. And so the fact that we can equip things to be internet enabled will make it feel as if things are rushing into this internet environment. So I think that the Internet of Things phenomenon is going to be something of a tidal wave, and I'm quite worried about it, because for it to be useful, we are going to have to establish common standards and user interfaces so that we'll be able to make use of these devices. None of us wants 80 to 100 apps on our mobile trying to find the right one to turn the light on in the living room. So we clearly need to think our way through making this much more coherent and much more interoperable. So I think that we still have a lot of work to do, and it's going to take time. We may have lots of devices out there that are internet capable, but making them work as a cooperative ensemble may take some time.
Very good. You've mentioned that it's very important for building reliable and updatable software. What is, in your view, the key thing that we need to do now so that can happen in the future?
Well, I suppose one answer would be to shoot all the programmers, because they're the ones that make all the bugs. The honest answer, this has been very hard. For 70 years or so, we have tried to write software that has fewer or no bugs, and we have not succeeded. There was a period of time when people thought they could prove the correctness of the software. We soon learned that was pretty hard, too. But there is something we can try to do. And now, I'm speaking now as a person who used to make a living writing code, writing software. And that's to create programming environments that are, in some sense, conscious of the code that we're writing. This is going to sound a little corny, but I don't even know how that translates into Portuguese. But imagine that you have a piece of software which is sort of watching you as you're writing the code. So it's like having something sitting on your shoulder. And it's watching to see what you're writing, and it's trying to understand the context of the software. And I can imagine that this little piece of software, which is sitting on my shoulder, is saying, wait a minute, I see a buffer overflow problem. What do you mean you see a buffer overflow problem? It's on line 47. Oh, several bad words. So then I'll fix that. Or maybe I can ask it and say, do you see any places where I use a variable without initializing it with a value? Just a second. Yeah, I see one or two of the variables over there at the top. So, I mean, the idea of having software help you find the bugs or maybe prevent you from making mistakes could be a very powerful contribution. So for students who are looking for PhD dissertation topics, this sort of software environment that minimizes mistakes could be a really powerful contribution.
Your last slide mentioned about the importance of promoting entrepreneurship. In your view, which regions or countries today are best promoting and putting public policy in place to foster entrepreneurship in the digital age?
Well, I think that we are trying pretty hard in the United States, and I think that here in Brazil, you are also, from the internet point of view, trying to create an environment where internet entrepreneurship is supportable. Google is quite interested in this. We've created something we call Campus up in São Paulo. It's essentially a building full of entrepreneurs plus some Google engineers to help them. But it's not just about the ideas. We met some really interesting young people that you'll meet later tonight, I guess, who have brought some very, very interesting network-based ideas and software-based ideas. We want to recognize them as part of the WCIT program. But there is more to this than just ideas and implementation. How do you get capital? Is it readily available? Is there a way to limit the liability of the people starting companies so that there's some risk is taken away from that? Do we have the notion of limited liability companies? In the United States, There is something in our corporate law called Chapter 11. It basically says to a company that has essentially gone bankrupt that it, instead of simply dissipating its resources, liquidating, we have something called Chapter 11, which says you can reorganize yourself. You are permitted to negotiate with the creditors an arrangement where the creditors may not get all of their money back, but you're permitted to try to recover the company. Jobs get saved. The institution continues. The users who were dependent on the products or services of that company may ultimately still get access to those products and services. So this notion of forgiveness in the corporate sector has been a pretty powerful mechanism to help entrepreneurs to accept the risk. In the venture capital world, of course, you're a smart venture capitalist if you recognize that maybe 60, well, actually more like 80 to 90% of the companies that you invest in are not going to succeed. What you pray for is that one or two of them will succeed and make up for all of the other losses. So here in Brazil, in the US, and other parts of the world that recognize the need to support risk and to accept the possibility of failure, I think are two key elements in encouraging entrepreneurship. Just one other point on failure. In Google, for example, there is a fairly healthy recognition that some ambitious projects are not going to work. We would much rather have our engineers and our product makers, product managers, try to do something very ambitious and fail, rather than only try to do little incremental things. And so if we're willing to accept that risk, we can have potentially big outcomes. And the same should be true here in Brazil and elsewhere.
We see that many times over in the real world, in the real business world, cultural differences have an impact on the desired business outcome. How do you see those cultural differences playing with an internet business-based society?
This is actually a very perceptive question. We were just talking about risk and failure. And there are some cultures in which failure is really quite damaging from the cultural point of view. In Europe, I think there is a lot of hesitation to take risk because a business failure might leave a permanent mark on your forehead. In America, there is more tolerance for business people who take risk and might possibly fail. I haven't ever had this choice to make, but I am imagining that if I had two candidates coming to me as a venture capitalist to be possible CEOs of a company that I'm supporting, and one of them has had a failure, a business failure, and the other one has not, I might be tempted to take the one who has had a failure because that person might recognize the symptoms before the other one would and be able to do something about that. But there are cultures where failure is culturally serious and not recoverable. And so the willingness to tolerate risk, I think, and failure is a very important cultural element in entrepreneurial activity. That's why you see so much entrepreneurship taking place. I don't know what is the situation here in Brazil, to be quite honest with you, but if there is intolerance for failure, maybe that somehow needs to change to allow entrepreneurs to try their ideas out.
Last question, Vint. Someone is very curious, considering that they think, and it's probably true, that you know the whole internet inside out. How do you protect your password?
Okay, so I have a very good answer to that. First of all, you don't tell anybody. The trouble is, you have to tell the computer on the other end or it won't recognize you. Oh, I use a solution that Google has required of us as employees. It's called two-factor authentication. Basically, I have a little chip that's plugged into my laptop. That chip does a full-up cryptographic Diffie-Hellman exchange. And if that sounds like a buzzword, just trust me, Diffie-Hellman is one of the most powerful key generation mechanisms that we have in our inventory. So that little chip basically is activated by the Google server in the cloud. I type in my username and my password, and before I can get into the system, it activates the chip and says, please touch the chip to activate it to get it to do the exchange. If someone else has my username and password, they can't get in unless they also have the chip, which is the second factor. We've had other implementations of that, for example, where an SMS message is sent to your mobile by the system that received your username and password. It's a second channel going to a second device. Personally, I think SMS is probably less trustworthy or less safe than we would like, and so that would not be my favorite way of implementing two-factor authentication. But that's primarily the tool that I use. There are some cases where there are applications that don't have second-factor authentication. And in those cases, I try to make sure I don't use the same password twice. I try to be religious about changing the passwords. I have hundreds of them, and so they are put away in an encrypted file in order to protect them in case I need to go look it up, because honestly, I haven't memorized hundreds of passwords, and no human being should be expected to do that. So that's my story, anyway.
Well, Vint, we have come to the final checkered line. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
You're welcome.